You're listening to For Real Radio with Bria, Julia, Kayla, and Michael on WHITRadio.org, the sound of Hudson County Schools of Technology in North Bergen, New Jersey.
All right, good afternoon, everyone, and welcome to our weekly special edition of For Real Radio with special guest Mr. Jefferson. Thank you for being here.
Thank you for inviting me.
Okay, and today we actually are going to be discussing women's equality then and now. Obviously, we know about women's suffrage back then. We know about the 19th Amendment. But what I really want to get to now is there still an issue with female equality today? Let's start. Mr. Jefferson, do you think that's still an issue?
I'm very curious what the female perspective might be. So I will defer to Kayla first and then come back to me.
Kayla.
Wait, what was the question?
Okay. Do you think that women's equality and is still an issue today?
Yeah.
Okay. Why?
Like inequality within like jobs.
Everywhere.
Yeah. Well, mostly with jobs, I guess, I'd say.
Yeah, this is Mr. P. 75 women earn on an average 75% of what a male earns for the same job.
There may be a good reason
yeah,
for that.
What is it?
What is
what
that
could
a good reason?
Maybe it could be with having babies. Men, until very recently, until the Family Leave Act signed under the Clinton administration, men didn't have the option of taking paternity leave. Women could. So if a woman is going to take, say, I don't know, just make up numbers, say 3 months out of the year, you know, once, twice, maybe three times in their career, they lose productivity. The company makes less money, they take home less money, especially if they get paid by the hour. But that's just an average. That's just 75. I've seen 82%, 87%, whatever it is. That's just an average.
But should they be penalized for having babies?
I don't see it as a penalty. I know this is just a man's perspective on a woman's thing.
Yeah.
But I don't see it as a penalty for having a baby. I see it as if you don't work, you don't get paid.
Well, you don't maybe you shouldn't get paid for 3 months, but here that we do at the Hudson County Schools of Technology, I think they get a paid leave for 3 months, and
yeah.
Most progressive countries have that intact. So I think it's a good rule.
Things got better.
Yeah. And what about the woman that doesn't start a family? Does that 75% less also cover?
All women. It covers. It's not the criteria isn't whether they have babies or not. It's just they don't earn on an average.
The 75% is the average, though.
Yeah.
Because Mike is right. If you have a woman who is working at company A doing the same job as man,
yeah,
she gets paid the same.
She should be.
She is.
Not necessarily. I mean, a lot of corporations do not.
Where is there a woman doing the same job as a man?
Anybody out there, 201-854-8224, please call in. If you're doing the same job as a man and you're getting less money, we'd love to hear from you. I've read it. I mean, I don't know personally. I'm sure people do know personally where women have the same responsibilities, same duties, but they're not getting the same pay.
I have a story for you about a woman in the workplace in my family.
Right.
She did work for this company, and the supervisor took all the men out in the company to Hooters.
That's a kind of very sexist
right, that
place.
Is.
Yeah.
And
but no one is naked, though, so it's just a restaurant.
Of course. Right. And she did make a complaint, and what do you know? She lost her job.
Now, was she upset that she didn't get invited too, or was she upset that they went to a place that...
Now, I think if everyone was invited, that would have changed, she was upset. She wouldn't have been upset. But, of course, Hooters does have a reputation for being the kind
sexist.
Of coquettish restaurant that it is.
Well, let me ask you, is there anything wrong with that? Doesn't it seem like a restaurant like that glorifies females?
No.
Women aren't made fun of. Women are kind of held on a pedestal.
Right, but I think it almost degrades them because it simply focuses on their physical
assets
and just that. It's only physical. It's not deeper.
I mean, in one way it does glorify them, but in other ways it takes, you know, it's obviously taking advantage of of what a woman has.
Yeah, but these women still choose to work there.
Yeah.
Well, that's like saying strip clubs glorify women.
Or I've been to Hooters once. I've never been to a strip club.
It's the same.
Twice your age.
That's the same thing. Do we have a caller?
We have a caller.
We do, though, right?
We do have a caller.
I'm
going to
take
so,
that.
So put on the phone. And,
hello.
Hello. This is Afni with an important call for Candace Seegert.
Oh.
This is
Afni.
Candace Seegert.
We're going to drop that.
Who is Candace Speaker?
That seems like you.
All right.
Wrong number.
We actually, you know, it's amazing that we actually called for a call. And we got someone to call, but not exactly
and
what we're looking for.
It was Afni, the female robot. There you go.
I guess we need somebody to screen the call.
Yes.
All right. So, that's a conversation. I mean, Hooters definitely is within the realm of mainstream, I would think, and they have every right to do what they do, but we kind of know what that's all about.
Oh, yeah, and the name is Hooters, you know.
Right.
A little double entendre there.
Right.
It's pretty out there.
Right.
Let's hear from Kayla. What do you think about this, the objectification of females? As our female expert for the particular show here, what do you think?
Well, as like for like Hooters and stuff, I mean, I don't think it glorifies women in like a good way. Like Michael said, it kind of sort of degrades them because it's not like, it's just on their physical appearance.
Mm. Oh, but they still choose to work there, don't they? I mean, nobody's
I mean it's a job, just like females choose to still work at a strip club or something, so...
There you go.
Well, what do you think about the male version of stuff like this? You know, like the Chippendale dancers and bachelorette parties. Is there a reverse to this kind of sexism? Do women talk about this stuff and complain about how Chippendales objectifies the men?
I don't know. Like, I don't know. I think it's different with like women. Because we already have that problem with, like, inequality, so it, like, highlights it more. But with men, it's different because they're already, like,
Have you ever worked in a place, Kayla, where you were making less money than somebody, some male who was doing the same job?
No.
Never had that experience. So.
I have something for you. Have you ever worked in a place where...
Never worked anymore.
You never worked?
No.
Okay, so, because a lot of times there are, and I hear this, especially with waitresses in some restaurants in my town, where they're subjected to some, how do I put this? Some sexual harassment by, you know, cooks and by other employees, male employees, and they don't do anything in fear of losing their jobs because they need a place to work.
I think when it comes to, like, women, like, not getting some jobs and, like, inequality with jobs, like, I think that's the problem.
Right.
Like, the attraction between the female and the male, like, that would cause a problem. Like, I don't agree with some women not getting jobs, but I understand why it would happen.
Like what? Like what kind of
like,
jobs?
Like, okay, in a business, let's say more guys work in a construction thing, and then... We have, like, a woman as, like, I don't know, like, sort of running it, like, as an assistant. Like, obviously, that would have some problems there. More guys and then a girl, there'd be some tension. You know?
Would you, let me ask you this question. Would you be more secure or safe if you saw a male cop coming to help you or a female cop coming to help you?
That's a good question.
You're in a tough situation. You're in a really serious kind of gangland shootout, and you need some help. Somehow you got caught in a crossfire. Say, who would you like to see coming to your rescue? Be honest.
I don't know.
Or would it not make a difference?
I don't think it'd make a difference.
Okay. I have a question for you though. You're driving, right? And you just got pulled over.
Mm-hmm.
Who would you feel more comfortable approaching your car, a female cop or a male cop? Not because with the gang violence and everything, that kind of focused on ability to better the situation. But in this case, just what would make you more comfortable?
Honestly, I don't know if it'd make a difference to me. Like, they're going to give me the same ticket either way.
That's fair.
This is where Kayla would say, I'm not a typical woman driver. I wouldn't get pulled over. I didn't break the law.
There you go. No, man.
There are all kinds of stereotypes.
Yeah.
And stereotypes don't just disappear into thin air, and they don't just disappear out of thin air. There has got to be some little kernel of truth to make these stick around so long.
Absolutely. Yeah. Well, another thing I've noticed, you know, we see all these heinous crimes and these terrorist attacks, and not once, I'm sure there are cases out there, but majority of them that you see are done by men.
Mm.
True.
The
ones that make the news, but there were a couple of female suicide bombers who were Palestinians who attacked pizza places and coffee shops in Jerusalem. But
when?
2005, 2006. Long enough ago to make it ancient history.
Right, right.
You know, in the Twitter age, it's
right.
You know, might as well be prehistoric.
And that's why I said, you know, there are cases out there, but it seems like we see a majority of men doing all of these terrible acts. And why do you think that is? I don't know. Is it? And this.
I think the more aggressive. The male is the more aggressive creature and the more violent creature, even in nature. You look at even tigers, lions, that they're the more aggressive. Even though the female lions do most of the hunting, when it comes to protection, the male lion is the one. So it may be a matter of testosterone. I don't know.
Oh, no, right. Yeah. No. It is a matter of testosterone. Testosterone is a very interesting chemical. It can do great deal of harm to a man.
Yes, it can.
Not physical harm, but
it has its positives and negatives.
Right, it does sometimes blind a man.
Yeah.
It's interesting how testosterone and progesterone are the yin-yang of the sexual chemicals, and they're in reciprocal proportions from male to female, like 80-20 testosterone to progesterone from men, 20-80 progesterone.
Mm-hmm.
80-20 progesterone to 20% testosterone for females. They're reciprocals.
Yeah. So, I mean, that seems like it has a pretty big difference on how a man conducts some of his behavior. Testosterone seems.
Mm-hmm.
I actually heard something once. It was, if women ran the world, there would be no wars, just countries wouldn't speak to each other for a long time.
Right.
And I think, you know, that's how it is. Men are so quick to jump to war a lot of times. They, like you said, they are very aggressive.
And they get over it. They blow up, and they get over it. A woman, 30 years is a little short on the chart for getting over it, you know. Mm-hmm. So they kind of hold grudges for decades, some women, their whole lives.
You know, I was speaking to some senior citizens, and I've spoken to some old people from my block, and this has come up a lot. They say, I didn't think that we would see a black man in the White House before a woman.
That's something definitely to talk about. How in the world did we have a Barack Obama before Hillary Clinton?
Or Hillary Clinton.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that goes with, I don't know the actual. How it went with voting rights.
We still may get Hillary Clinton.
Yeah,
I think she's going to run.
I hope not,
right, Mr. Jefferson?
I don't know. I like her.
You like her?
As a person, she is charismatic. She is smart beyond belief. She is very, very smart. The only person I might like on a personal level more than Hillary might be Condoleezza Rice.
All right.
You know, they're both very intelligent.
Right,
they both are capable of being the president. They've been around long enough to know the president doesn't have a whole lot of power. The president's got only a small amount of power.
Mm-hmm.
But all the blame ends in the White House.
Yeah.
You know, I thought about this back in 2008, and I remember McCain, he was not elected. But I couldn't help think that maybe if he would have had Condoleezza Rice as a vice presidential choice, that he would have definitely
It may have been closer. I don't know if he would have won, but it may have been closer.
I don't know if anybody could have beaten Barack Obama. The cards were marked from the start. Not even in terms of voter fraud, just in terms of people who didn't vote voted for him just to say, I voted for a black man for the presidency.
No, I agree.
Now I'm not a racist.
I agree.
And I voted because I wanted this guy to win. Well, why do you like him? I don't know.
Right. And I'm going to admit, back in 2008, I was not pro Obama, simply for the fact I didn't want to jump on the bandwagon that I would just want to vote for this man because he's a certain color, and that annoyed me when I heard people say that.
I'm just about twice your age, and I have friends and colleagues and people that I know who voted for Barack Obama twice, and I asked them, "So are you satisfied with the job that Obama's done?" And they say, "No." Would you vote for him again? Yes. That just makes no sense, you know. But that's exactly how he's won election and re-election. People vote because I want to be part of history. I want to be on the side of the winners. My vote should count. I got to vote for the guy that I think is going to win. That's the worst reason to vote for anybody. Vote for the guy that matches your values.
Chris, Mr. DePiro has something.
I just feel that a lot of the people voted against the Republican Party.
Yeah. Anybody but Bush.
Because they really just did, you know, a horrible job when Bush, you know, in my opinion or whatever. But really, I think they just were fed up with the whole Republican Party, went Democrat, and
I think that in the case for re-election, too.
I don't know if it had anything to do with the color of skin and wanting to be trendy and saying, oh, I vote for a black guy. You know, Obama's half white.
Yeah.
Also, so he's not only the first black president, he's the 44th white president.
Yeah. Well, what do you think about the job that he's done in the past 4.5 years?
I love him. I think he's done a tremendous job in the worst circumstances. Coming in to the situation that he did and where we are now with the stock exchange and the deficit going down. I mean, where
I
has
think
he
we
gone
could
have, wrong?
We could have been a lot worse situation, I think.
What do you make about Benghazi, the IRS investigating?
If you want to be specific, then we'll be specific. In general, he's amazing.
Yeah. Yeah.
And as far as Benghazi and the IRS, I think that's just the Republicans, you know, throwing something against the wall and hoping that it sticks because they can't stand a black man in the White House.
I've been with my history classes covering Watergate for the past couple of days with Kayla's class, and I've noticed so many parallels between the Nixon White House and the Obama White House now. The president doesn't do anything wrong. The president is above the fray, but the guys at the bottom level are interpreting what the president wants and doing all kinds of bonehead moves.
Well, Nixon did something wrong.
And once he got involved in the cover-up, that was where things got wrong. You could say there's something about Benghazi. Obama had nothing to do with dropping the ball on Benghazi or ordering the IRS to investigate conservative 501c3s, but now that he knows about it, what's been happening? Who got fired? Who got put in prison? How did this become prevented from happening again?
Didn't someone get fired?
The administrator of the IRS.
Okay.
But this has been going on since November of 2011. Why wait till now? Here's the trouble. If the president knows about this, it's illegal. If he doesn't know about this and it happens anyway, it shows him to be incompetent, it's a lose-lose for Obama either way.
Well,
I think you can go back to any presidential and find something wrong with every president.
Absolutely. And to me, that it's one of the interesting things about the presidents. We make them out to be such, you know, gods and kings, and they're just ordinary people. We've had presidents that fathered illegitimate children. We've got presidents that may have had, you know, homosexual relationships. We've had presidents that have cheated on their wives.
Look how FDR died.
He did. His mistress is in the room.
Yeah.
You know, not his wife, his mistress in the room.
Right. Well, and I think as far as the IRS and everything surfacing now with Obama, is I think the Republicans are getting desperate. They need something. They are looking for any opportunity to really get this man's numbers down. And if you've been looking at the numbers, his numbers have gone up because they make themselves look that way. They're as transparent as glass. We know what they're doing. And I think it's hurting them more than anything. And as far as re-election goes, I don't think he was re-elected in simply because he was black. I think he was re-elected because it was the less of two of a crazy. We had Mitt Romney. My gosh, did he gaffe or what with that whole 47% statement? And
was he wrong?
I think he absolutely was wrong. Yeah.
Obama won with more than 47%. I think he was right. There is, if you study politics enough, there is a certain loyal block of Democratic voters
right. And
a certain loyal block of Republican voters. The Democrat candidates will never buy the love of those diehard Republicans. They'll vote for Adolf Hitler if Adolf Hitler's a Republican. And if it was the other shoe on the other foot, they'd do it the same way. There's only this narrow band in the middle, maybe 15 to 20%, if that, that you can clamor over, that you can fight over.
But the way that he stated it, he didn't say there's a certain amount of Democrats that aren't going to vote for me because I'm not Democrat. He said there are a certain amount of people, you know, that fall under a category of income and that are going to use the safety net and not vote for me because they just won't. He didn't, unfortunately, I understood what he was trying to say.
Yeah, I'll give you this, that he didn't articulate it as well as he should
have.
He
sure didn't.
There have been a dozen at least candidates in the past 20 years that have tried to dumb down their rhetoric because they believe that the American people are not intelligent enough to understand them. So they don't speak what's on their mind. Mitt Romney was the latest of these people.
And he thought he was in a very safe environment. He was at a very wealthy party, with surrounded by, you know, his constituents, his Republican constituents, and he got a little too comfortable.
Mm. Well, I really, you know, I didn't know this election what the Republican Party really was for. I didn't understand it. Their message wasn't clear. All I saw was let's the wealthy people stay wealthy, and let's do everything we can to protect the wealth. That's what I thought their message was.
This country has been built on the idea of being wealthy. Come to America not for the equality of the result, but the equality of the opportunity. Opportunity to what? To be wealthy. Mm-hmm. You know, let's not despise the people that we would like to become. The system doesn't always work for everybody, but...
Well, obviously, we didn't be... I mean, we're teachers, John. We're not aspiring to be wealthy, or else we would be in a different profession. I don't think everybody...
I have enough money to pay my bills.
Right.
I don't need stockpiles of money. I consider myself wealthy because I have a beautiful family.
All right.
I have the greatest job in the world. I come to school. I come to work, and I hang out with you guys.
In a radio station.
Yeah.
WHIT Radio.
.org.
And to go back to that, I actually think this country, you know, was formed not to be wealthy, but to be prosperous and to be free. That's originally why our founding fathers came on over here. They wanted freedom.
How do you measure prosperity? Do you measure prosperity into freedom? How do you measure
freedom? I think that is it.
I can measure freedom as I have no obstacle in my way of pursuing money. Nobody says, no, you can only make this much, you can make this much, you got to work over here, you got to do this. I have no obstacle in my way of making money.
That's
how I can measure freedom. I, as it happens, I work in a place where I have no obstacle for anything. So if I want to sit and talk about women's rights, I can.
That's what I think freedom is. I think it's the idea to express thoughts, to express beliefs, to love freely, to practice whatever religion you want. I think that's freedom. I think money is something nice that comes with it, but it doesn't make freedom.
You can learn to live on $2 a day.
Well, that'll do it for today, folks. Thank you, everyone, for tuning in to WHIT Radio at WHITradio.org.
This is a man's world. It said Sam Walton should be given the Nobel Peace Prize.
This is a man's world. But it wouldn't be nothing. Without a woman or a girl, you see, man made the cars to take us over the road.